Hi students, welcome back to my channel, and in this video I will be explaining the properties of alcohols. For this I have taken the questions from JEE, NEET, AIEEE, KCET examinations. Right, let us see the questions and answer almost all properties of alcohols. The first question: among the following compound, which can be dehydrated very easily? Which alcohols will undergo dehydration easily? What is dehydration? D means detach. Detach means remove. Removal of what? Hydrate. Removal of hydration is called as dehydration. So which alcohols will undergo dehydration very easily? The ease of formation should be, the ease of dehydration should be very, very high. So which one will undergo? Now for that you should know the nature of alcohol. What is this alcohol here? Alcohol is the one where in which hydroxyl group is present in either alkyl, normally saturated carbon. So here this carbon is connected to OH, and which in turn connected to only one carbon. The carbon containing OH is connected directly to only one carbon. So this is called as 1 degree alcohol or primary alcohol. This is primary alcohol. Compound A is primary alcohol. In this case, this OH is connected to this carbon, which in turn connected to 1 and 2. So 2 degree alcohol, that is secondary alcohol. Compound B is secondary alcohol. Now come to see, in this case this OH is connected to this carbon, which in turn connected to 1, 2 and 3, that is 3 degree alcohol, and this is tertiary alcohol. Primary alcohol, secondary alcohol and tertiary alcohol. Whereas in this case this carbon contains OH, and which in turn connected to only one carbon, so this is also primary alcohol. So there are two primary alcohols, one secondary alcohol and one tertiary alcohol. Now here the tertiary alcohol will undergo dehydration readily than the secondary alcohol, which undergoes more easily than the primary alcohol, which is more than that of methyl alcohol. That is the order of dehydration. So if you remember this, you can answer. But if you do not remember, then it is a difficult thing. So for that, if you know the mechanism of the reaction, that means if you know the path of the reaction, if you know the path to the solution, you can easily answer the questions like this. So it is better to remember, or rather understand the path of the reaction, rather than remembering some wild things. So here how the reaction takes place is most important. That is, how, what is the mechanism of the reaction? The mechanism is here dehydration. The dehydration of alcohols takes place in presence of dehydrating agents like concentrated sulfuric acid or phosphoric acid. Normally phosphoric acid is used for secondary and tertiary alcohols at a different concentration. Now this step of dehydration, the mechanism of the reaction, takes place in three steps. It follows three different steps. The first step is protonation of OH group or alcohol. Protonation of alcohol. Who will protonate this? Acid will protonate. Proton from the acid will go to the alcohol and becomes protonated alcohol. How it goes? The pairs of electrons, lone pairs of electrons which is there on the oxygen, takes up this H plus ion from the acid. Once it takes plus, right, one electron of oxygen will be given to this and forms a bond. So this proton will be there on this alcohol, and this proton is there in this alcohol, leading to the protonated alcohol. As a result of this, when here oxygen has given one electron to hydrogen, once it gives electron, the positive charge will be developed on the oxygen. It loses one electron to hydrogen, hence it becomes positive charge. Here oxygen is more electronegative than carbon and hydrogen. So this is oxygen is more electronegative than other elements present in it. Oxygen, that is more electronegative element, can have a negative charge but not the positive charge. So if it has the positive charge, that is unstable. This cannot be there for a longer duration. It cannot be stable, right? It has to be decomposed. It has to neutralize. The positive charge has to be neutralized, right? So how it is neutralized? That happens in the second stage, and that is the formation of carbocation. First step is protonation of alcohol. Second step is formation of carbocation. How it is formed? Here the positive charge on the oxygen will be neutralized. How it is neutralized? The electrons present between carbon and oxygen. So oxygen is connected to carbon, so the electrons present between them will be migrated to the oxygen to neutralize the charge on the oxygen. So when it is neutralized, the bond between oxygen and carbon will be broken, because these electrons will be completely transferred to the oxygen. Once it is transferred, the bond between carbon and oxygen will be broken. So once it is broken, this H2O will be free, and that comes out as water. So during this process, carbon loses an electron and becomes positively charged. So the carbon containing positive charge is called as carbocation, or also called as carbonium ion. So this is the slowest step of the process. Slowest step of the process is the rate determining step. It is the step which will decides the speed of the reaction. The ease of the reaction will be depending upon this carbocation. So what is this carbocation? What is the nature of it? That is that will be known by knowing the carbons connected to the carbon containing positive charge. Here this carbon has the positive charge, which is in turn connected directly to only one carbon. So hence it is called as 1 degree carbocation or primary carbocation. If carbon containing positive charge is connected to 2 carbons directly, if it is connected to 2 carbons directly, then it is called a secondary carbocation. If carbon containing positive charge is directly linked to 1, 2, 3 carbons directly, then it is called tertiary carbocation. In this case, the speed of the reaction depends upon the stability of the carbocation. If the formed carbocation is more stable, then the ease of formation is very high. So if this is more stable, then the ease or the speed at which this will be forming is more. How can we know that? Here we know that tertiary carbocation is more stable than secondary carbocation, which is more stable than the primary carbocation. From where this tertiary carbocation will come? It will come from tertiary alcohol. Secondary carbocation will come from secondary alcohol. Primary carbocation will come from primary alcohol. Methyl carbocation will come from methyl alcohol. So by knowing the what carbocation that is forming, we can tell which one will undergo reaction readily. So from this tertiary carbocation, if the carbocation formed is more, that means the ease of formation is very high. So this tertiary carbocation will obtain from tertiary alcohols. So that means to say that tertiary alcohol will undergo dehydration readily than secondary, than primary. So here, so that is so we can get the answer. But let us complete the mechanism. The first next step of the mechanism is formation of alkene. How it happens? Here the carbon which has a positive charge, this positive charge has to neutralize. To neutralize, the nearby next or immediate carbon will donate. How it donates? It takes away the electrons of hydrogens, carbon connected to hydrogen, right? There is a bond. This bond will migrate to this. How it is migrated? Here, to migrate that, this H plus has to be taken care, or it has to be taken away. That will be taken away by HSO4 minus, that is the conjugated base of acid, that is sulfuric acid. This HSO4 minus takes up H plus to become sulfuric acid. Once it takes up, this bond between carbon and hydrogen migrate. Once it migrates, there will be double bond between carbon and carbon, and thus there will be formation of alkene. Alkene formed in this case is ethene. So here H plus will be taken away by the conjugated base of either sulfuric acid or phosphoric acid to give the corresponding acid. So these are the 3 steps involved in the formation of alkene, right, by dehydration process. So in this method, already told in this for this example, this is a primary alcohol giving rise to primary carbocation. This is secondary alcohol gives to secondary carbocation. This tertiary alcohol gives tertiary carbocation. And this is again primary alcohol gives primary carbocation. In this case, this tertiary alcohol, that is this compound, will undergo dehydration readily than B, that is secondary, than tertiary, that is primary. The tertiary undergoes a dehydration readily than secondary, than primary. So this is how the reaction proceeds, right? So you should, if you know the mechanism, you can easily answer the reaction, right? And in fact, for the secondary and tertiary alcohols, we can use milder reagents like phosphoric acid. So this is one of the important reaction, and in the on this there are many questions. In the previous slide, I told you about dehydration reaction, and here let us see the selection of the reagent for the reaction. If it is a primary alcohol, concentrated sulfuric acid at 443 Kelvin, we can bring out dehydration to give alkene. So ethyl alcohol reacts with the concentrated sulfuric acid at 443 Kelvin, it gives alkene, right? Similarly, if you take a secondary alcohol like isopropyl alcohol or 2-propanol, isopropyl alcohol or 2-propanol, for this, instead of concentrated sulfuric acid, we can take 80% phosphoric acid at 440 Kelvin. So at 440 Kelvin, in presence of 80% phosphoric acid, it gives propene. So propene is obtained by dehydration reaction. This is also alkene. So here it is 98% sulfuric acid, whereas here it is 80% phosphoric acid. If it is tertiary alcohol, for that 20% phosphoric acid is sufficient, and temperature is 358 Kelvin. So remember this, so it could be any questions on this could be asked, right? So this undergoes dehydration to give 2-methyl propene. So 2-methylpropene can be obtained by dehydration of tertiary butyl alcohol. So these are all the reagents for primary, secondary and tertiary alcohol. So here this reaction leads to the formation of alkenes. Now let us see another reaction, the reaction taking place at 413 Kelvin in presence of concentrated sulfuric acid and large amount, excess amount of ethyl alcohol. Here also dehydration takes place in presence of concentrated sulfuric acid. Instead of alkene, you will be getting diethyl ether. So diethyl ether will be obtained by dehydration of ethyl alcohol at 413 Kelvin. So excess amount of alcohol reacts with sulfuric acid at 413 Kelvin to give diethyl ether. Next, if the temperature is below 413, then if you add dilute concentrated sulfuric acid drop by drop to this ethyl alcohol, it gives ethyl CH3CH2 ethyl. This is hydrogen, ethyl hydrogen S44 is sulfate, ethyl hydrogen sulfate is obtained again by dehydration. So you will be getting ethyl hydrogen sulfate by interacting ethyl alcohol with dilute concentrated sulfuric acid at 413 Kelvin. And from to this ethyl hydrogen sulfate, if you add ethyl alcohol to this ethyl hydrogen sulfate, if you add ethyl alcohol, again it gives diethyl ether with the formation of sulfuric acid. This hydrogen sulfate, this will take up this hydrogen to the sulfuric acid and leads to the formation of diethyl ether. So these are all the different reactions happening with the same material, that is ethyl alcohol and sulfuric acid. Sulfuric acid can give ethene, diethyl ether and also ethyl hydrogen sulfate. Three different products could be obtained under different conditions, right? So this has been asked in some of the examinations. Now let us see the reactions, questions appeared in other examination. During dehydration of alcohols to alkenes by heating with concentrated sulfuric acid, initial step of the reaction is OF. It is already, I told you that it is a protonation of OH group, that is alcohol of the molecule, right? So first step is protonation of the alcohol. Formation of carbocation is the second step, that is after protonation it forms a carbocation, and of course along with that for elimination of water takes place, it is again second step. The formation of ester, no, it is not a question, right? It doesn't happen here. Next question, it has appeared in IEEE 2002. The following reaction, CH3 times Br, that is tertiary butyl bromide, reacts with water, gives CH3 times COH, that is alcohol. The tertiary butyl alcohol is formed. Here, H2O is a neutral nucleophile. It doesn't possess a negative charge, but it is neutral, containing the oxygen. Oxygen has two pairs of electrons that act as a nucleophile. This is a nucleophilic substitution reaction. Here it is not the elimination reaction, it is replacement of substitution of Br by OH. So it is substitution reaction. Free radical reaction doesn't take place here, since it is an attack of a nucleophile on this, actually first formation of tertiary carbocation and then this water molecule go and attacks, leading to the formation of the tertiary butyl alcohol. So it is not electrophilic substitution reaction, neither elimination nor electrophilic nor free radical substitution reaction, but it is nucleophilic substitution reaction. An ether is more volatile than an alcohol having the same molecular formula. This is due to what? Dipolar characteristics of ethers, alcohols having resonance structure, intermolecular hydrogen bonding in ethers, intermolecular hydrogen bonding in alcohols. So let us see this, right, how this is possible. Now here, for that let me take an example of ethyl alcohol. In this case CH3, CH2, O and H. If you see the nature of this hydrogen and oxygen present in this molecule, hydrogen is electropositive, oxygen is more electronegative. And as a result of that, since hydrogen is connected to more electronegative oxygen, so this oxygen pulls electron towards itself, this pulls the electron of hydrogen towards this. As a result of that, this oxygen gains negative character delta minus. As this hydrogen loses electrons towards oxygen, this hydrogen gains positive character. So this is positive and this is negative. And when this is present in a container, what will happen is, right, H plus of one molecule attracted by the O minus of another molecule of alcohol. H plus of one molecule of alcohol will be attracted by the O minus, the O delta minus of another molecule of alcohol, and as a result of that, there will be a bond between oxygen and hydrogen. Oxygen of one molecule with hydrogen of another molecule of alcohol, and that bonding involving hydrogen is called as hydrogen bonding. So because of this hydrogen bonding between the molecules of alcohols, that is intermolecular hydrogen bonding, leading to the formation of associated molecule of alcohol. That means one molecule of alcohol will be associated with another molecule of alcohol by means of hydrogen bonding. So to separate this bond between one molecule of alcohol with another molecule, we need more amount of energy. That means it has to be heated to very high temperature, so fairly high temperature. So that means the boiling point of alcohols are more because of hydrogen bonding. So here I have explained that alcohols are having high boiling point. Then what about ethers? How it is more volatile than alcohols? Let us see that. So for that, I have supposed to take the similar ether having the same molecular formula. For that, it is CH3OCH3, that is dimethyl ether is most appropriate. Here for simplicity, I have taken diethyl ether. For simplicity, I have taken diethyl ether, right? Just to explain this. In this case, oxygen is connected to carbon and carbon, right? So here this is more electronegative than carbon, but this is not connected to hydrogen directly. So that means in this case, there is no hydrogen bonding. So since there is no hydrogen bonding between the molecules of ether, right, so they will not be held by hydrogen bonding. So hence, energy required to evaporate, this will be less. So these molecules can be separated easily by heating to low temperature. So these molecules are held by van der Waals force of attraction, but not by hydrogen bonding that is found in case of alcohols. Alcohols are having higher boiling points than that of ethers. It is mainly because of intermolecular hydrogen bonding present in the alcohols, but that is not there in ether. From amongst the following alcohols, the one that would react fastest with the concentrated HCl and anhydrous zinc chloride is what? The mixture of concentrated HCl and anhydrous zinc chloride is called as Lucas reagent. And this reaction is also a test to distinguish between primary, secondary and tertiary alcohol, right? Let us see that. Now here, this 2-butanol, 2-butanol, that is secondary alcohol. This is 2-methylpropanol, this is a tertiary butyl alcohol. EPC name is 2-methylpropanol, propanol. And 2-methylpropanol, this is a primary alcohol again. 1-butanol is also primary alcohol. Now let us see which one is primary, secondary and tertiary alcohol on the basis of the reaction which is happening. So that reaction happening is very simple. So alcohol reacts with HCl. So here dehydration takes place in presence of anhydrous zinc chloride to give water and alkyl halide. OH will be replaced by Cl, right? Cl present as the acid, right? So you will be getting alkyl halide. From if it is primary alcohol halide, secondary alcohol halide, tertiary alcohol halide will form, right? Now let us see this, right? Let us see the reaction. Reaction is this, right? Now let us see what will happen with the different alcohols. And the reaction is alcohol is made to react with anhydrous zinc chloride and concentrated HCl. Now when you treat it with tertiary alcohol, it gives precipitate immediately to give the formation of RCl. It gives a precipitate. Precipitate is due to the formation of alkyl halide. So precipitation is due to the formation of alkyl halide. It happens immediately. Whereas with secondary alcohol, it gives the precipitate. That means reaction takes place after 5 minutes. It is not instantaneous as like tertiary. It takes place after 5 minutes. Whereas in case of primary, it does not take place at room temperature, but it forms only on heating, right? So this is a distinction between primary, secondary and tertiary alcohol. Tertiary alcohols gives precipitate readily. Secondary alcohols does not give precipitate readily, but it gives after 5 minutes. Whereas the primary alcohol does not give precipitate at room temperature, but it is only on heating. So this is the distinction between primary, secondary and tertiary alcohol. Of course, this is another question altogether. Now here, what is that we have to find out is identify which one is primary, secondary and tertiary alcohol. Already given, right? So what is that, right? So primary alcohol, this 2-butanol is OH is connected to carbon, which in turn connected to other. So this is secondary alcohol, right? Next, 2 methyl 2 propanol 2 methyl 2 propanol. So these are two at second position, 1 2 3 of the propyl group. There is OH and CH3 on the same carbon. So this is nothing but tertiary butyl alcohol. This is a tertiary alcohol. So this undergoes reaction readily than the secondary alcohol. Next example which they have given is 2 methyl propanol. So at the second position, methyl group is there. This OH containing carbon connected to directly connected to only one. So therefore, this is a primary alcohol. So this is a primary alcohol. So this reaction takes place at end, that is only on heating. Now butanol, 1-butanol is also a primary alcohol because the carbon containing OH is connected to only one carbon. This is a primary alcohol. So these two are primary alcohols. This is a tertiary alcohol and this is secondary alcohol. So B, that the 2-methyl propan-2-ol will undergo reaction readily. The fastest reaction will happen at tertiary butyl alcohol. So this is Lucas reagent test, right? And this reaction proceed by SN1 mechanism, right? Substitution nucleophilic unimolecular reaction depends upon the formation of carbocation, right? So tertiary carbocation forms readily from this alcohol. So that is the reaction that is happening here, right? Next, an unknown alcohol is treated with Lucas reagent to determine whether the alcohol is primary, secondary, tertiary. Which alcohol will react fastest with what mechanism? So mechanism already told you, which one will undergo reaction readily, that's already told you. Tertiary alcohol undergoes readily than the secondary, than the primary, right? What is given? Secondary alcohols by SN1 mechanism, right? So this will not be the fastest one, only the tertiary will undergo at fastest rate, right? Tertiary alcohol by SN1 will undergo faster rate than the secondary, than primary. So this is not SN2, it is not, this is not a nucleophilic substitution reaction, it is SN1 reaction. So tertiary alcohol undergoes by SN1 reaction. The most suitable reagent for the conversion of RCH2OH to RCHO is what? KMnO4, potassium permanganate, strong oxidizing agent. Potassium dichromate, it's also strong oxidizing agent. Of course, CrO3 and PCC, this chromic nitrate, and pyridinium chlorochromate, these are all relatively milder oxidizing agents than dichromate and permanganate. Now here, the best reagent for the oxidation of RCH2OH, that is primary alcohol to aldehyde, is primary alcohol to aldehyde is pyridinium chlorochromate, that is a mixture of pyridine, HCl and CrO3. So this mixture, right, will be become a pyridinium chlorochromate, that is the best reagent for the oxidation of primary alcohol to aldehyde. So this is very important, right? Please remember this. Then what about the chromic anhydride? This will be a good reagent for the oxidation of secondary alcohol to ketone. So for the chromic anhydride, we'll oxidize secondary alcohol to ketone. So this is the best reagent for it. And doesn't mean that this will not convert a primary alcohol to aldehyde. It do. But best reagent for the conversion of primary alcohol to aldehyde is pyridinium chlorochromate. For secondary alcohol to oxidize that, the best reagent is chromic anhydride. Anhydrous condition is most important here. So this is the best reagent. Other oxidizing agents are, right, we will come back to this permanganate and dichromate. Other oxidizing agent used for this oxidation is heated copper. Copper at 573 can oxidize primary alcohol to aldehyde. It will can oxidize primary alcohol to aldehyde. The removal of hydrogen, two hydrogens are removed here. Removal of hydrogen is oxidation. Whereas secondary alcohol, here also two hydrogens are removed, right, and leading to the formation of ketone. So at the same temperature and at same conditions, the copper at 573 Kelvin, secondary alcohol becomes ketone by oxidation. Whereas tertiary alcohol with a heated copper at 573 Kelvin, it gives propene, 2-methylpropene will be obtained. Here H and OH and dehydration takes place, leading to the formation of propene, right? So here again, so these are the reagents used for the oxidation of primary, secondary and tertiary alcohol. For tertiary alcohol, chromic anhydride or pyridinium chlorochromate have not been used. Now we'll come back to this strong oxidizing agent. This strong acidified potassium permanganate, strong oxidizing agent like permanganate and dichromate, oxidize the alcohols to corresponding carboxylic acid. So this oxidation reduction reaction are the natural process which are happening in the nature. Especially oxidation is a natural process happening in the nature. So normally what happens is when alcohol on oxidation gives aldehyde. If it is a primary alcohol, it gives aldehyde. If it is secondary alcohol, it gives ketone, which on further oxidation gives carboxylic acid. It will give corresponding carboxylic acid, and this carboxylic acid on further oxidation gives carbon dioxide. What? This is the ultimate product of oxidation. So if this forward reaction is oxidation, reverse reaction is reduction. Reduction of acid will lead to the formation of carbonyl compound like either aldehyde or ketone, that depends, right? And which are further reduction gives alcohol, right? So these are all the processes which are happening. Reduction of alcohol, carbon dioxide, water to polyhydroxyaldehyde and ketone are happening in the nature, that is formation of glucose and fructose, which is happening by photochemical reaction, that is a reverse process. So naturally oxidation is the one which is happening in the nature. So alcohol to aldehyde, aldehyde that is carbonyl compound, that is number one, further oxidation gives acids, then further oxidation gives carbon dioxide, water. So remember this conditions, these reagents, and they are very important for the examination. A liquid was mixed with ethanol and a drop of concentrated sulfuric acid was added. A compound with the fruity smell was formed. The liquid was, what is that? So a liquid is mixed with ethanol in terms of concentrated sulfuric acid, and the resulting mixture is, the resulting compound is having a fruity odor, right? So what is that compound, right? So this is appeared in AIEEE 2009. The reaction, its expected reaction is, the fruity odor is mainly due to ester. The ester will form when an alcohol, that is ethanol we hear, is made to react with the carboxylic acid to give the ester, right? So when ethyl alcohol reacts with acetic acid in presence of concentrated sulfuric acid, because this reaction is a reversible reaction, so the sulfuric acid acts as a dehydrating agent between OH and acid to give ester, right? So this is the reaction which is happening between a liquid. The liquid is expected to be carboxylic acid and reacts with alcohol in presence of concentrated sulfuric acid to give ester, and this reaction is called as esterification reaction. The fruity smell is due to ester formed by the interaction of carboxylic acid with ethanol. So the acid which is interacting here, the compound, the liquid which is interacting here will be or should be a carboxylic acid, so as to get a fruity odor liquid. So alcohol given is ethanol, then the carboxylic acid given in this choice is methanol, is not an alcohol acid, this is an aldehyde, formaldehyde, this is acetone, that is a ketone, and acid is acetic acid. The choice is acetic acid. Acetic acid reacts with ethyl alcohol to give ethyl acetoacetate, and this is the ester that is going to form. Another question that could be asked here is, oxygen connected to ethyl group will be, is it from the acid or from the alcohol? Here I have shown it here. O is in green color, this O is also in green color, that means this oxygen connected to the ethyl group will come from ethyl alcohol. The oxygen connected to the ethyl group in ester is from the alcohol. This is from the alcohol. This is another question that you can expect, right? The oxygen connected to the alkyl group of the ester, will it be from acid or from alcohol? But it is here, the answer is, it is from alcohol. That question could be expected on this. The next question, the best reagent to convert a pent-3-ene-2-ol, so 3-ene, it's a enol, into pent-3-ene-2-one, so alcohol to ketone. 2-ol means, it's a, 2 means secondary, it's a secondary alcohol to ketone, right? So it is a ketone, so that this is possible only with chromic anhydride, right? So pyridinium chlorochromate will convert primary alcohol to aldehyde, so here one is a ketone, so it is not. Then here chromic anhydride and glycistic acid, it has to be anhydride of chromium, so chromic anhydride is the best reagent for this, so answer is B. So acidic chromate, no, that is acidic chromate convert the alcohol into an acid, acidic permanganate will convert again alcohol into an acid, so these two converts this into acid, whereas chlorochromate is for the primary alcohol to aldehyde, so alcohol to ketone will be from chromic anhydride, right? Chromic anhydride and glycistic acid will convert our secondary alcohol into ketone. Phenyl magnesium bromide reacts with methanol to give a mixture of anisole and magnesium hydroxybromide, mixture of benzene and magnesium methoxybromide, a mixture of toluene and magnesium hydroxybromide, mixture of phenol and magnesium methyl bromide. Remember, it is a reaction between Grignard reagent and methyl alcohol, right? So reaction is between methyl alcohol and Grignard reagent. Here in this Grignard reagent, the R group, that is either alkyl or aryl group, will be having negative character. This is a carbanion. This carbanion can easily attack electropositive components in the compound. In this methyl alcohol, oxygen is more electronegative than carbon as well as hydrogen, and as a result of that, this hydrogen will be electropositive. This will have carry positive character. This is positive in nature. This is labile. This is loosely adhered to the oxygen of the alcohol. That means this can be easily taken away by the anion. So here what happens is C minus, the anion of the aggregate reagent, takes up, the anion means this carbon anion, takes up this proton, that H plus to give C6H6, that is benzene, and the remaining is CH3O minus, that will get connected to magnesium methoxybromide. So here, the any compound which contains labile hydrogen, the hydrogen connected to most electronegative element is called as labile hydrogen or loosely held hydrogen. That can, the hydrogen will be in the form of proton that can be easily knocked away by the carbon ion that is there in Grignard reagent. It could be from alcohol, even from amine, hydrogen connected to most electronegative element nitrogen can also be knocked away and giving rise to benzene and the corresponding compound. So here we will be getting magnesium methoxy, then bromine and benzene. Benzene will be obtained. Anisole will not be formed because this will not be connected to this. This is not here. This itself is negative. Here also this is negative. This also negative. Not possible. So this benzene, magnesium, methoxy, bromide will form. Phenol will not be possible. OH minus is not there. So that is not possible here. Here again, toluene, the CH3 will not, cannot be separated from oxygen. So toluene cannot be expected here. So answer is mixture of benzene and magnesium methoxy. Here methyl alcohol can be written as MeOH. Normally it is written in the form of MeOH, where Me stands for CH3. So remember this. So Me for methyl, for E, whereas ETH, ethyl can also be represented as ET. So ETOH means ethyl alcohol, right? So these are the shortcuts that are normally used in the while writing the structure of the compound. So other reaction, because of this labile hydrogen, this alcohols can easily reacts with the sodium to give sodium alkoxide, sodium alkoxide with the liberation of hydrogen, right? And in fact, this is also a test for alcohols, to test when the sodium is metal is added to this, it liberates, there will be liberation of hydrogen. You can see the effervescence, you can see the bubbling in the test tube. That bubbling is mainly because of liberation of labile hydrogen of the alcohol, so that is hydrogen of OH will be liberated as hydrogen gas. So that will happen with sodium. So you'll be getting sodium alkyl oxide. If it is ethyl alcohol, sodium methoxide. If it is methyl alcohol, sodium methoxide. Likewise, you get this. Similarly, this alcohol, this instead of sodium, you can take aluminium to interact with tertiary butyl alcohol. This is one of the important reagent. So when the tertiary butyl alcohol is made to react with aluminium, you'll be getting tertiary butyl methoxide. Aluminium tertiary methoxide. This is one of the reagent used in the chemical organic synthesis, right? So these are the two important reactions of alcohols with metals. So metals can replace hydrogen of the alcohol to give corresponding metal oxides. So here aluminium oxide, aluminium tertiary butoxide, whereas here sodium butoxide or alkoxide. In the following sequence of reaction, ethyl alcohol in presence of phosphorus and iodine gives A in presence of magnesium and ether gives B. B in presence of HCHO, that is formaldehyde, gives C. C in presence of water gives D. The compound D is what? Butanol, aldehyde, it is butyl alcohol, alcohol, N-propyl alcohol, again alcohol, and propanol, it's an aldehyde. Two aldehydes and two alcohols are given. Let us see this. This is another important question that is normally been asked in JW examinations. Right, let us see that, right? So here, first reaction, ethyl alcohol is there. It is made to react with phosphorus and iodine. These two mixture, when you mix these two, you will be getting Pi3. This Pi3, when it is treated with alcohol, it replaces OH by I. So OH will be replaced by I, and this Pi3 will become H3PO3. And this compound is alkyl halide. That halide is iodide. So you will be getting alkyl iodide. This is compound A. Compound A is ethyl iodide. This ethyl iodide is made to react with magnesium in presence of ether. So this is a well known Grignard reaction. Reaction of alkyl halide with magnesium to give alkyl magnesium halide. Here ethyl halide reacts with magnesium to give ethyl magnesium iodide, that is Grignard reagent. That compound is B. So this B is made to react with formaldehyde. When it is treated with formaldehyde, reaction takes place. This anion will go and attacks to the C of the carbonyl group, leading to the formation of CH3, CH2, and this aldehyde CH2, all the carbon and hydrogen, oxygen of aldehyde will become a part of the molecule, that is propyl oxy magnesium iodide, right? Propyl oxy magnesium iodide will form here, right? So addition takes place to give rise to this intermediate species. when this is subjected to hydrolysis, this compound is C, when it is subjected to hydrolysis by adding acid or even water, the bond breaks here, H will be taken up by O and OH will be taken by Mg to give CH3CH2OH, that is propyl alcohol, that is normal propyl alcohol or 1-propanol plus magnesium hydroxyiodide. So this is what will happen when ethyl alcohol is made to Pi3. Pi3 gives Pi plus I2 gives Pi3, Pi3 gives rise to CH3CH2A, that is ethyl iodide, that compound A. A on treatment with magnesium to give ethyl magnesium iodide, that is compound B. This compound B on treatment with formaldehyde gives this propyl oxy magnesium iodide, that compound C. And this C on hydrolysis using either dilute acid or water leads to the formation of N-propyl alcohol or propanol with the formation of magnesium hydroxy iodide. So here the answer is here, that is N-propyl alcohol. It is not aldehyde. You will be getting N-propyl alcohol. Hi friends, please ask questions on the chapters which you want, and do you want more shortcut methods? Subscribe to my channel, like this video, share with your friends, and thank you very much for your nice hearing. So please do subscribe to my channel.